Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Futuresteading. Live like tomorrow matters. Practical skills, recipes and rituals for a simpler life. Written and read by Jade Miles. Dedication. For Mum. Cherry. A rock for all time. You are a solver of problems, an endless giver of self, a clear and calm thinker, and assertive in spades, but fair to the ends of the earth. My luck in getting you in nature's draw has been my secret power since 1977. I learnt most of it from you. This book was scribed on Palangangmadang country. It's breathtakingly beautiful and fertile beyond imagination. It's our home. On this patch, we've realised our lifelong dream of planting and nurturing a heritage orchard and berry farm. Our practices are regenerative and we mimic Mother Nature in every way we can. We've made our mark on this land. As the years plod on and generations pass, we hope that these well-intentioned actions bear fruit. But that's just our story. What I can't tell you is the story of this land before white settlement. I don't know how the hills rolled, where the creek flowed, how the sun fell, which plants and animals flourished, or what kinds of patterns and pathways were made by the people who walked this country for tens of thousands of years. This land is stolen. Our forefathers rewrote the rules to separate people from place, people who are inseparable from place. For all of the work that our family has done, it's little more than a hiccup within the timeless stewardship of First Nations peoples. Today, I acknowledge that this place I call home was never ceded. Whatever the piece of paper says, we cannot own this land, demarcated by palings and wire, any more than we can own the sun, air, or birdsong. As current custodians, we pledge to learn as much as we can about its Indigenous past, especially the stories and wisdom of those who came before us. We stand in awe and recognition of the rich culture that propagated and maintained a complex food production system on this brittle continent for countless generations. It is a way of landscape-scale farming that we may never fully comprehend. We cannot heal the damage, but we will spend our lifetime trying. Preface. On fire. Time for change. Let me take you back to the beginning of 2020. 3 January. As the mushrooming clouds of bushfire smoke threatened villages in our valley and the evacuation notices went out, it suddenly got real. Charlie's day out fighting fires yesterday was long and hard, and something in his voice was adamant when he asked me not to be here with the kids tomorrow while he's not here but in the bush. I resisted, of course, but actually he's right. So I'm prepping, packing the car, moving the horses out and kissing the geese, chickens and sheep on the heads, wishing them luck and heading off. Our cars are full of petrol, our phones are charged, our firebox with woolen blankets and coats plus emergency rations is by the door, and I have a battery-operated radio. I've got the emergency app on my phone and I'm alert with a plan of action in the back of my mind. Am I being overcautious? Having someone in our household who works in fire management not only heightens our sense of responsibility, but also means that we must be prepared at home so he can be sure his family is safe while he is away at another fire. Do you have a fire plan? 6 January. Each day is the same, but not the same. At daybreak, he dons the smoky clothes that he dumped by the door at the end of his 12, 14, 16-hour shift the night before and leaves for more of the same. Where is he today? I don't know. What time will he be back? Late? I don't know. How long will these fires burn? I don't know. Is he safe? I don't know that either. He assures me they are well trained and always put safety first, but fires are unpredictable and things happen. They did, and now his heart races until it wakes him in the night. He's part of a crew I've never met, relying on comradeship I cannot fathom. His head swims with maps and briefings, incidents and strategies. He speaks a different language and has a fortitude that I can only imagine. He's building memories that I cannot share. It's like Groundhog Day on a bed of quicksand. I don't know what to expect, because no one does. As the wife at home, I do know that the days pass. The oppressive smoke gives the antsy kids sore throats and headaches. The farm is mined to keep ticking along. The niggle of worry is just below the surface. The need to keep life normal is critical, and any fire plan that I have to enact for my own safety and that of the farm will need to be undertaken on my own. Yet, I'm grateful. Despite my now embedded dread of summer and the inevitable fires that come with it, I have my house, my garden, my kids, the most incredible support from relentless daily messages, a husband who comes home more often than not, a village that has not faced fires this season, and a country that has a rising desire to see genuine change. We must change. We will change. We've been bad house guests for too long, and Mother Nature is done. As the landlady, she holds the ultimate power, and unless we change, we will be done too. I was so grateful for those on the front line of this, but they can't do it on our behalf forever. It's time for all of us to consider what our role in this is. What will you do? How will you change? 8 January. The pantry is bare, and so is my resilience. Fortunately, the food co-op reopens today, so I'll refill my jars with whole foods and locally grown food. I'll share a cup of tea with whichever volunteer is staffing the shop and see other members who've become like family. It's time to come out of the cocoon I've been in while Charlie has been fighting the fires and the smoke has blanketed the farm, which I've not been courageous enough to leave. It's been a foggy, heady, grit-your-teeth kind of week. But for all of its heartache, I chiefly feel buoyed by the sense that our country is galvanising, becoming resolved and clearly seeing what it needs to do. 11 January. I waved him off for night shift and waited for the change to come. My restless head and listless body found calm in the mundane. I planted more corn, watered the patch, and stood in the chicken coop while the angry wind blew hard in every direction, trying to make up her mind. And while she did, I made up my mind too. I'm a list writer, so I sit here now with the wind buffeting the windows and doors, the sky getting heavier, and texts from worried friends shooting in like gunfire. I'm writing my list of everything I can do to make a difference as just one person, wondering what can be done. What does your list include? 13 January. He's on night shifts this week. He spends 14 hours each night walking through the bush with a drip torch in hand, backburning, raking, rescuing dazed wildlife and putting out spot fires. I imagine there's an eerie, time-stand-still kind of loneliness that stretches into the inky night, but he tells me there's jovial banter, two-way radio instructions and plenty to do in the glow of the burning bush, so time actually ticks by quickly. He's not contactable once he drives out our gates, so I distract myself with anything on offer and a reassuring internal monologue that loops. Despite the long nights, he returns each morning to resume his role as father and farmer, doing his best to be present for the kids' stories and to help me edge along my to-do list. Today, we strung wire in the hoop house so that I could get the tomatoes onto strings. I couldn't do it on my own. While the bed was beckoning, he stood upright for just a little longer to be the second pair of hands I needed and to feel like we're standing side by side, in this together. The smoke-filled air, emergency app and fire roster are the sun we're orbiting at the moment. A usual summer family rhythm doesn't exist, but somehow he knows that even just one cup of tea, one quick round of cards and one small need your help on this job makes all the difference to us, at home, waiting for this to all come to an end. He's tucked up asleep now, and the house is quiet so we don't wake him. My breathing is slow, the kids aren't bickering, and the house feels complete until tonight when he drives out the gates again. 14 January. The smoke cleared, the garden winked green, the marigolds bobbed, and we were lured towards this feeling of simple bygone summers. It's not, of course, and perhaps it can't be again, but I'm confronted to find that my deep desire for this memory to be the reality is as strong as my determination not to forget the fires. As much as I yearn for it to be my favourite season again, I'm clutching to the earnest commitment that I made to myself, my kids, my firefighting husband, and the hundreds and hundreds of individuals who've been made homeless, lost business income, been stranded, felt fearful, been inconvenienced, and most of all, become galvanised in their commitment to create a different world. I will not be dissuaded from my commitment to making individual change. I hope I'm not alone. These words from my diary still lock my throat and make my heart race. It was the summer that galvanised my desire to write this book. As our climate warms and our country cooks, we Australians are now accustomed to bracing ourselves for hot summers. But in 2019, 2020, country and city cousins were united when our collective eyes were open to the burden that we now face nationwide, actually worldwide. The grief of our nation shook us hard to the core, shouting, "Wake up!" like never before. We can no longer be apathetic or ignorant about the impact of climate change. We need to adapt and build hardened in this together resilience as awake individuals who live in connected communities where each and every one of us, regardless of race, age, sex or income, has a right to live vitally. But we can't expect this to be the responsibility of everyone else. We each need to look hard at ourselves and consider how reliant we are on extractive industries, how much waste we generate, how committed we are to our localised food systems, how much we contribute to the well-being of our communities, how much we consume, what happiness or success really is, how much knowledge we have of the natural world, whether we respect the seasons, how we show respect for one another. Most importantly, we have to assess our genuine desire for change. I know that we're each capable of starting right now in our own households and our own communities in our own ways. This will look different for everyone, and that's to be celebrated. For me, the first step was to start a podcast and write this book. It's been one hell of a learning curve, and the climb is still steep. The words I've written will never be complete, or indeed right for everyone, but they will spur thoughts and start conversations between people, all of us. We cannot let all of the heartbreak, hard work, fear, and fire in our bellies go to waste. Now is the time for individual and then collective change. Are you with me? Part 1. The why. Introduction. Hello, how lovely to be in your ears. As you listen to the words of this book, I invite you to open your head, heart, and soul to the idea of living like tomorrow matters. To love every minute of today while cultivating a rich and fertile future. In theory, it's paradoxical. In practice, it's a deeply rewarding, deliciously challenging, and rather muddy pursuit. We're a family of five, two adults and three chillens living at Black Barn Farm, an 8-hectare, 20-acre orchard complete with feathered and furry menagerie in northeastern Victoria, Australia. Depending on the day and species, we're stubborn, idealistic, practical, whimsical, determined, exhausted, and peckish. If you popped in for a spontaneous cup of tea, you'd probably find me, Jade, weeding the veggie patch while fielding a call from the local food co-op. Charlie might be in the orchard or waist-deep in a research paper detailing the most effective organic pest control methods, and the kids would be roaming on their bikes, testing recipes in the kitchen or in a flurry of responsibility and initiative, feeding the chickens or fishing for dinner. For the better part of a lifetime, we've pursued a considerate, regenerative, hands-in-the-dirt existence. We've coined the term Futuresteading for this way of life. We haven't always got it right, but we've amassed a personal inventory of experiments, failures, and revelations. These are hard-won lessons about identity, community, and what makes a good life. In this book, I'll share the most practical and evocative parts of our story. Whether you're seeking a fail-safe pickling recipe or inspiration to start living like tomorrow matters, there's something to tickle your fancy, I'm sure. And before you ask, a life in the countryside complete with enamel milk jugs isn't a prerequisite for making use of this book. The principles and philosophy can be applied anywhere, whether you're in a high-rise urban rental or a backyard caravan. In fact, I'm not inviting you to move to the countryside and become self-sufficient. I'm challenging the current paradigm, the story of endless growth and chronic consumption that is making a meal of our future. I believe that we can all do our bit, concrete or literal jungle dwellers alike. To plant a tree is to believe in tomorrow. To plant an orchard of fruiting trees is the ultimate act of optimism. The future is in our hands. None of us can escape it, this future. We'll be present in our children and our children's children, or as ghosts, compost or atoms, depending on your beliefs. We have a duty of care to this land and every human and non-human thing that springs from it, and we are cared for in turn. The time to start exercising our custodial responsibility is now. It's time to share stories, challenge norms, tap out of consumerism, celebrate local, cultivate connections and actively seek slow. It's time to lead lives with more ritual and less rubbish, more culture and less consumption, more seed sowing and less scrolling. We have to build tribes, put down roots, shadow the seasons, and draw insight from our disillusionment. It's time to eat with intention. What we put into our mouths, or grow and prepare ourselves, is a thrice daily statement of purpose. Make it local. Make it count. It's time to accept that we are part of, not in control of, the natural world. It's time to dive into Futuresteading. If you're feeling overwhelmed by the magnitude of this task, then keep listening. You'll soon discover that something as small as a pot of mint on your balcony can amount to activism, or simply observing the seasons can forge a relationship with Mother Nature that is so strong you'll defend her no matter what. Most of all, this book aims to fill us with hope. Not an addictive and false sense of hopium, but a practical and evocative stimulant for change. The sharing of deeply considered ideas and a compassionate way of life will provoke thought, challenge norms, encourage simplicity, and provide tools to create rituals that will connect folk to themselves, to others, to the natural world, and to the powerful pull of a seasonally evolving year. Wherever you live and whatever stage you're at, you can write a new story with your choices. You can do things that feel good and are meaningful and achievable on any scale. And you can find comfort in the ever-expanding tapestry of like-minded people who are strengthening their commitment and pulling together for a better tomorrow, today. I'm so glad that our stories can overlap. Jade. What is Futuresteading? Simply put, Futuresteading is living like tomorrow matters. The term riffs on homesteading and has roots in permaculture. Actions are localised, simplified, slow and food-oriented, but most of all, cultural. How can we supplant our current hurtling towards destruction culture with a new one that values tomorrow? Futuresteading starts with gently guiding our thoughts and actions towards a sense of permanence. We need to reimagine our routines and rituals so that they give back to, not take from, the planet. Our decisions should contribute to a steady, vibrant, vital and joyful tomorrow. Futuresteading asks, what tiny but significant thing can we do to make a positive change right now? Then it celebrates the act of having a go. Futuresteading honours contradiction. It acknowledges that living with integrity involves accepting the straight-up hypocrisy of everyday life, that thinking deeply about tomorrow means being okay to live in today, and that pursuing an earnest and noble existence works best with a big old belly laugh and by encouraging a small group of individuals to bring a magnitude of change. Futuresteading is a mindset powered by real people and local places, not faceless corporations or government. It defines success as a healthy family, great relationships, an elegantly frugal household, a tight-knit community, acts of kindness, creative fulfillment, integrity, ritual, connection to the natural world, and simply being human. In celebrating everything that money can't buy, success is suddenly within everyone's reach. Futuresteading is not a prescription, but an invitation to honour the future in ways that work for you. Far from insignificant, your actions and intentions add to and energise the change that's happening right now within our communities and beneath our feet. Can you feel it? We can all do it, starting right now. Rob Greenfeld, an environmental activist dedicated to sustainability, has said, "There are millions who know the world's problems, but very few who are willing to change their actions to reflect this. Now is the time to be excited about beginning a radical transformation." What does a Futuresteader look like? You. You've been brave enough to pick up a book with a nonsensical name, so my guess is that you also have a whimsical and curious disposition. You're not afraid to ponder the powerful question, what if?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.